So some of you probably have heard of the Pareto Principle, which is, in simplest terms, it's 20% will produce 80%. And so it's used in a number of ways. For marketers, it's used as a sales pitch, sometimes a sales pitch of an authentic product, which is that I will be able to predict for you the patterns that will enable you to kick butt. So basically, where's your 20%? Find where your 20% is and focus on that. And then when you focus on that, you can keep, I guess, kind of theoretically, I don't, you know, I'll just say theoretically, you can keep going down to maximize what that real, what the real work, what the real fruitful work really is. And then the Pareto Principle is also used in a lot of ways, you know, to try to understand why hierarchies emerge. A lot of, like Jordan Peterson with his old lobsters, hierarchies, and then Pareto principles just showing, you know, again and again. And I think there's some truth to it, but showing again and again that it just seems to be this built-in, this is the claim, which I don't think you can objectively say for sure is true, but the claim is generally that this is indicative of some biological human reality, that it's just bound to be that 20% of the humans will produce 80%. Or now I've heard Jordan Peterson. I haven't been able to find this anywhere else. So, and any of you folks that are whatever statisticians or whatever who would look into something like that, I think it would be statisticians, right? For the Pareto Principle, I don't know. Then you can tell me if there's any credibility to this. And the idea is it's not just that 20% produce 80% of the fruit. It's that it is it's a square root of the total will produce 80% of the work. So it's like if you have a company of hold on, I can do math. I do math. I'm gonna say I think it's maybe 10,000. No, okay, just a company of 1,000. Company of 1,000, and that's no, company of 10,000. You got 4 zeros. That's good. Okay, company of 1,000, 4 zeros. So the Pareto principle, as you understand it, would be that 200 people would produce 800 or 80% of the fruit. But what I've heard Jordan Peterson say is that no, it's worse than that. It's the square root producing 80%. So it's the square root of 10,000 is 100. So then we're talking 100 people producing 80% of the work. And then that's when you start to see why it is that maybe these hierarchies emerge. What I don't know is the degree to which one is a biological reality and one is a sociocultural conditioning process, or which degree. Okay, 2,000 people, Mr. Spikes? Okay, whatever. Don't check my math. Okay. So, as you guys can tell, I'm not a math. I did say I'm not a statistician. So, and I guess statisticians don't, you don't have to be a statistician to understand the math that I did wrong, but that's beside the point. Let's just focus on the fact that I said I'm not a statistician. So my thought that I've been thinking about is, well, my thought that I've been thinking about, dude, my thought that I have been thinking about is there a way that humanity can come to clearly understand the degree to which either it is a biological human reality? And if so, then the idea of eliminating hierarchies is going to be real problematic. Or is it sociocultural? And then there's other questions, like even if it is a biological reality now, if can sociocultural conditions override that biological reality? I don't know the answer to that question, but it does seem to me that, you know, something that I'm thinking about And I don't have an answer to this, and I'll just plead it out here and see if anybody else has any thoughts about it. And that is peaks. That peaks are they're alluring prizes for barbarians. And the barbarians are the ones, and I don't mean this, you know, yeah, I'm going to just use the word barbarians because it's funny and it's colorful, but I don't mean it in a negative or positive sense, okay? This is not a judgment of what I'm describing. This is just my perception of what I believe is. So barbarians, you know, they're not attracted to areas that don't have big fatties inside them. They just don't care. I mean, they might ride through there, but they just don't care. You know, when the barbarians, or if you're Mike Tyson, the barbarians. I stole that joke from my brother Bill, but whatever. But anyway, the barbarians in 39 BC. I'm old school. I know. I don't think I'm going to go with the BCE, CE thing. It's not a religious thing. It's just that I'm old school, man. It was BC and AD, and I'm sticking to it, man. I'm keeping it alive. Okay. I'm an artifact from a bygone age, the BC AD age. But anyway, around 390 BC, the barbarians showed up in the form of the Celts. Celts. And the Celts, they came down, and they didn't really sack Rome. They didn't sack the inner core of Rome, but they sacked the outer core of Rome. And they didn't really rape, pillage, and plunder so much as they just took some stuff. And then the Romans were like, yo, man, here. And then they were like, oh, man, we good. Good. Got ourselves some big fatty stuff. And we's on our way now for the Gauls. Well, I guess they weren't Gauls yet. They would have been just, I don't know. Anyway, for the Celts, I think the lesson that they learned is, you know, man, these big fatties, you know, you can just run down there, man, and just like get yourself a little feces and just, go back up and, replenish your, resources and all that. And, it's all good, man. That's good. That's the lesson they learned. And the lesson the Romans would learn was, holy fuck, dude, we got some big high motherfucking peaks. And a lot of people out there, they're saying them big peaks ain't, they're not miraculous. They're not patriotic. They're not heroic. They're just big fatties, big juicy fatties. I'm going to eat that shit, man. I'm going to eat that big fatty. That's what they are. They're just big fatties. Big fatties for barbarians to eat. And the barbarians, I mean, they're just like human beings. They're like, yeah, man, I figured out a way to make myself some monies and some, not, it's not even monies. It's not monies, whatever. Even when people say monies, it's not the monies, man. It's whatever they're getting with the money. So, you know, for them, I don't know what it is that they get, whether it's the prestige or the fucking or whatever it is, man. It doesn't really matter. So they're getting their monies or their whatever they're getting for this. And there's a system that offers these nice peaks and doesn't really have a lot of consequence for people that go in and raid those peaks, eat the hell out of them, and then just kind of retreat back. And so the Romans, yeah, it fundamentally changed them. They became much more, I mean, they were already a very warlike people and kind of, I'll just use this word. By necessity, they were a warlike people pretty early on. So, I mean, it was a rabscrabble fight amongst multiple tribes to see which community, which society would exist. It's like a very tenuous hold on the land there. So yeah, they were by necessity pretty warlike and, you know, this existential humiliation, just fundamentally changed them. So what they do, man, they raise the cost of coercion, man, against them. They militarize out the wazoo. And I'm kind of one of those folks that I kind of look at that early history of Rome from say 390 to maybe 240 or thereabouts. I don't have the exact numbers in my head, but, or you know the exact years, but around about the time when they decided to you know to conquer Greece. They're like, you know what? Fuck you, Greece. You're no longer just like client states. Yeah, you're just a fucking province now. So yeah, when that time happened, I think things kind of fundamentally changed, and then the shift. I mean, even though they were projecting offensive power against Carthage, I do believe that Carthage was not just a boogeyman. Well, the first time around, maybe a little questionable. Second time around, definitely not the third time. Well, the third time around, now Carthage was nothing. Carthage is just like, you know, it was just this little spittle there, but it was making money. It was doing good. And then, you know, the Carthage, who was it? Crassus the center, or who was it? Cato the center, sorry. Cato, no, Crassus, the very opposite of Cato. But Cato the center says, you know, Carthage must be destroyed after every speech. And then they marched and leveled the city in, was it 146? I can't remember. I might have that date wrong. 146 BC. But anyway, up to that point, the Roman projection of power was defensive. In nature, it was real and or imagined. They perceive that. Listen, if you let certain neighbors near you, they're going to expand and they're going to threaten you. And they saw the Etruscans early on. For instance, the Etruscans, you know, they weren't as warlike because they had secured positions, and they were very happy with the fruits that they were garnering and the lifestyles that they were living for quite a significant period of time. So they kind of didn't have kind of the same exact environment. That's probably why they ended up getting their asses kicked in the end, even though it was the Etruscans that gave the Romans the gift of managing poo, because it was primarily the Etruscans that built the Cloaca Maxima, which is their sewage system, which parts of which still exist today. But at any rate, my point here is that wherever you have systems in which you have peaks, that they're just these big fatties, big delicious fatties that barbarians can feast upon. And the barbarians know that there's not going to be much recrimination. I mean, I'm talking about an instance of where the barbarians like ate and left. But they don't often eat and leave. They eat and stay. And then they eat that peak all up, and then, you know, what they replace it with a different peak. But that peak is fortified, motherfucker. That ain't good. When you look up and you see that peak, man, you see, like, bristling guns. You don't see big, fatty, tasty. So the idea is that basically, yeah, you have a system in which barbarians can easily come in, and then they can lock it down for periods of time until maybe stronger barbarians come that are able to breach the guns. But so the question is, what conditions would need to exist for human beings to be able to have communities, emergent communities, if you will, that naturally, well, naturally, I'll say, without the use of force or threat of force, with some gray interpretations thereof, but generally without that as the mechanism, without that as your management tool, what conditions would humans need to have in order to kind of find it very beneficial to not have these peaks? And so when the barbarians come and they raid, they have much smaller peaks. And even if they lock them up because their peaks are so small, other peaks around them can easily attract the folks that will suddenly find themselves being treated like Bethesda has decided to treat its core players. That's a gaming reference. And if you don't know it, it's Bethesda Games has released Fallout 76. And there's a lot of uproar about how that game has fundamentally changed what Fallout is. And Bethesda's response has been deemed as being tenured at best. And so Bethesda is kind of alienating its core audience to go after a broader audience. And it's, you know, it's, you know, what's happening in gaming is kind of what's triggering this conversation. So it's interesting. I'm taking it back to the gaming. I guess it's fitting, but what's happening to gaming is it's becoming lucrative. It's becoming very lucrative. It's a much bigger market than it's ever been. And now what does that mean? That means the big players are moving in, and the big players operate at mega scales with tons and tons of little zeros that come after the, you know, a whole bunch of little zeros open up their conversations with one another. That's the world that they live in. And all they're looking for is, you know, they're driven by these numbers to see increase. It's not enough to make as much as you did last year. It's not enough to make maybe 20% of what you did last year for, you know, no. You need to see increase, you know, whatever it is. You're always looking to get more. You are an ever expanding empire, and there's no Hadrian to come along and say enough. And that's, you know, Hadrian, you know, Trajan extended the borders to their maximums, and then Hadrian promptly pulled them back in the east and defined the limitations in the west, including, you know, the now famous Hadrian's Wall that divides Scotland from England proper. So that's the question. In gaming, big fatties were created, and they were created in an environment in which certain entities have already scaled certain peaks and locked them down, and they have huge monopolistic presences in marketplaces that don't allow for as much. It doesn't really give the people who were once your core. And I don't just mean in gaming. I'm talking about in a lot of ways. This is, it's gaming. You know, I think this is one of the reasons why I'm following gaming so much, is because this weird transition that's happening in gaming is I think pretty telling about the nature of systems that have allowed for these large scale high end peaks to first of all be just these unprotected big fatties that once the barbarians came in, the barbarians were able to lock it down. Well, gaming for a long time has kind of been a subculture, so its peaks weren't all that attractive to men who begin conversations with 12 zeros or whatever. I don't know. Let's say 6 zeros at the very least. They begin their conversation. If you can't start off with 6 zeros, you can't even have a conversation with these folks. So they're looking at maybe it's not even 6 zeros. No, maybe it's, I'll say it's 8 zeros. We're talking like 100 million minimum. So 8 zeros. Got to have 8 zeros in your pocket to have a conversation with these guys. So at 8 zeros, they're looking at gaming, and yeah, there's definitely attraction. There's folks making, you know, real money, and you know, there's you know, corporate involvement in gaming for quite some time, but for game developers, it's not been quite the same. Yeah, you know, the game consoles are making more collectively, way more collectively. Well, I don't know if this is true. Maybe it's not. So you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think, you know, I'm not going to say it. I'm not sure whether I would suspect that the game console, corporate folks make much more money on gaming than the actual developers do, and I believe the scales of you know, the AAA development companies of today have much bigger budgets, and they also have much bigger expectations, and the expectations is always more. More and more to in innovative ways. And whenever you see innovative ways, it's, you know, we just want people to buy as much as we possibly can get them to buy. And this is this is a natural thing. If you have the, if you have the ability to get more, people tend to want to take more, especially when they believe there's not going to be no really incriminating results from your actions. You have a realistic expectation that you're not only going to get away with it, but your lifestyle habits are going to dramatically increase in the very near future. So, yeah. Well, in the case of the eight zeros, their lifestyle habits won't actually be all that affected at all. Actually, they live at ostentatious, and they'll remain at ostentatious. It's levels that you and I can't even fathom. You know, when they take a sip of tea, it probably costs $10,000 somehow. Just somehow. I'm sure you can figure it out. I wouldn't doubt it. But that's what we're talking about here. So these guys, it's I think it's just more the prestige and the ability than to use your wealth to then influence the world around you in ways that some of us would consider pretty evil, subjectively so, but, you know, but within the framework of my preferences, evil. So I'll leave it at that. If anybody has any solutions, you let me know. Otherwise, I will bury my head in shame. I'll walk away, never to be seen or heard from again. Good night.